As we said at the very top of our broadcast tonight, we are talking about terrorism and how it affects us here in New York City and how safe we are. Happy finally to welcome our guest, John Miller, the NYPD's Deputy Commissioner of Intelligence and Counterterrorism. I know that it was difficult getting here tonight with all the snow, but thanks for making it.
My pleasure.
Okay, you double parked outside. Be careful, all right?
Okay.
You know, this is a really strong subject and a wide subject. And I know that you are right on top of everything that's going on. Recently, as you know, three Brooklyn men were arrested, suspected of trying to join ISIS and perhaps get involved in some terrorist activity. That was good work. And it's not the first time that law enforcement has done that. And when we say hats off to you, because that's part of what we're doing today, is telling people the good job that we're doing and the problems that are out there, but the good work that you're doing. So congratulations on that.
Well, thanks for that, Ernie.
You know, we also want to find out about what's happening with ISIS. We had a story on just a little while ago with Commissioner Bratton talking about, you know, the ISIS effort recruiting people online and the tremendous effort they're making using Facebook, all the social media. Tell us about that and how that's working.
Well, ISIS has combined a number of themes to become a very effective recruiter. If you take the other model, say Al-Qaeda, you know, Al-Qaeda promised kind of 1,000 years, mm-hmm. 100 years. It was a slightly vague plan of global jihad where governments might or might not fall sooner or later,
right,
and that they could sweep across the world. ISIS promises something extraordinarily tangible. Mm-hmm. It's what makes them exciting.
On a fast track, too, right?
They're not saying in 100 years.
Right.
They're saying there's a here and now. It's a physical place.
Mm-hmm.
They've planted a flag. They call it the Islamic State. They say, come and fight for us, and you can be a part of making this happen. They say, if you can't fight for us here on the ground in Syria, fight for us where you are.
What's the attraction, John? How are they able to lure in young people to buy into this ideology? How is that working?
Ernie, it's marketing. I don't think you could put it any other way. And it's not just marketing. You know, Al-Qaeda would put out an Anwar al-Awlaki video, and he would say things that are inspiring. But basically, it was one man talking to a camera, and he was very convincing.
Yes.
On the other hand, what ISIS puts together is a compelling set of videos, of Twitter feeds.
Yes, everything. Facebook.
Audio, Facebook, YouTube. And Ernie, when you think about it, who are they looking to attract? They're attracting mostly young men, mm-hmm. 18 to 35. And that is the generation that lives out loud. They live on Facebook. They live on Instagram. They live on Twitter. They tweet out their meals,
yeah,
and they post pictures,
you know,
of their every
that,
move.
I understand that, John, but where have we, as a society, where have we failed? I mean, young people to be so disenchanted, to be attracted to that.
Just to finish that thought, when they look at an organization,
right,
and they see here's an organization that lives on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, they're looking at an organization that lives in the very same way, on the very same platforms that they do.
Hmm.
And the message is that, that, you know, you can have three things. Now, it's subliminal,
right,
but if you peel back the messages, they promise valor, they promise belonging, they promise empowerment. And if you're somebody who has bought the narrative, believes in the cause,
sure,
that's a powerful argument. On the other hand, if you are someone who is living in the margins, you're not succeeding at work or at family or at school, you feel powerless, set apart, and not belonging, then it becomes an extraordinarily powerful message.
I can understand that, and I know, as you know, the White House is making an effort now to find partners, community partners, in a lot of Muslim communities across the country to try to counter these strong extremist messages. Do you think that's going to work?
I think it's going to work, but I don't think it's going to work tomorrow. I think that we are, as a country, and our Muslim leaders,
yes,
as community leaders and religious leaders, as a community, are behind the curve. What ISIS has done is they have embraced every kind of modern media, and they've managed to harness it, and they've managed to take these platforms and maximize them. What we're seeing is that our core Muslim leaders are putting out messages saying that this is the wrong narrative.
Mm-hmm.
Don't buy into this. Don't
right.
believe this. Don't go fight there. But what they're not doing is they're not using the same tools. They're not appearing in the same places. They're not reaching the same demographic. And it's a lot to ask of people who aren't really in the media business.
I understand.
They're in the community business.
Right.
They're in the religion business. They're imams and neighborhood people to have that capability. So one thing we would ask of the White House is, can you help empower them if they have a counter-narrative that's as compelling?
Mm-hmm.
Can you find them the tools or the resources to get to those platforms so that they can reach the same audience?
It's a tough question, but are we going to win this war against terrorism? What do you think?
You know, it is a tough question, and the answer isn't crystal clear. If you look at where we are today,
right.
Here's the good news. We're 12 years after 9/11, and we haven't had an attack on the 9/11 level on U.S. soil,
That's
despite
right.
probably 200 criminal cases that involve maybe 70 or 74 mm-hmm, plots mm-hmm, against mm-hmm. U.S. soil. On the other hand,
right.
two of the terrorist organizations that committed 65% of the killing in the name of terrorism, Boko Haram in Nigeria and ISIS, didn't even exist at 9/11, which means as we have gone forward and prosecuted and fought the war on terrorism, as we called it, terrorism has increased in some ways.
And John, people who are watching us, listening to you right now with the position that you hold, how safe are we in New York City? How safe are we?
Well, I would have to say in that we have been the target of 16 or 17 terrorist plots or terrorist motivated plots in more than a decade. And most of them have been thwarted mm-hmm. and detected or failed, that we're pretty safe. But you also have to ask, given that stellar track record.
Sure.
And I have to give a lot of credit to my predecessor, Deputy Commissioner Dave Cone and mm-hmm, Ray Kelly, and the machine that Commissioner Bratton continues to build on. We've been very good.
Yes.
A couple of times we've been lucky, and you can't take that for granted.
Hats off to you. I mean, a tremendous career in the Justice Department, law enforcement. Also a former reporter who understands what we do every day.
Who started in this very studio.
I know you started in this studio,
in this
which
room.
Is great. It's a homecoming.
It's nice to be back.
Yeah, John Miller, we appreciate the good work that you and your department and the NYPD and all law enforcement is doing, and thanks for trying to keep us safe. We appreciate
it. Well, thanks
that.
For having
Thank
me.
Thank you
it's
for being
good to
here.
See you again.
Thank you. Drive safely tonight, okay?
I'll do my
Watch
best.
Watch that car.